First of all, it's just beautiful in a very superficial, sort of idyllic way, just walking around here. You know, it was a really cool place to be. You know, I lived in New York City, and I basically worked within NYU, you know, with the giant cube and everything in the Village and whatever. And I felt bad for those people that they didn't have this. Like, I think psychologically, like, I needed a college green. Like, I needed a college feeling atmosphere, you know, not like a college just mashed into New York or whatever. And so, first of all, just the atmosphere in a real superficial kind of way, just for whatever reason, was really important to me. You know, and it's the journalism classes, they were small, you know, generally, or much smaller than like the general sort of 101 things that I had been taking prior. And you get to know everybody over the course of that time. I already knew many people. Like, you start taking classes with your friends, you can like plot these things out. Like, it was a nice, you know, 200, I'm trying to decide if I'm surprised by 200 people per class generally as a number, if I thought that was high or if I thought that was low, but it felt like less. And I think that's the way you want it to feel. You know, it's so weird because I didn't have a computer in my room until the end of my senior year. You know, like, I feel in some ways my experience now is radically different. So, like, what I remember, like, computer labs, you know, I remember, like, being in a Kinko's at, like, 4:30 in the morning doing stuff that obviously now I could just do from wherever. And so, like, just physically moving around like that, even though it was inconvenient, was also kind of interesting and also kind of cool. You know, it's like we were like right on the cusp of big internet, you know, before it completely took over people's lives, and like the really smart people already knew about it, and people like me sort of more gradually sort of realized it. But it's weird. It was like 1 foot in each, you know, BC and, you know, AD that way. You know, the two things that I did in my time here that I'm fondest of, you know, at the time and certainly now, is The Post and ACRN. You know, it's like a budding sort of rock nerd or, you know, insufferable kind of person. Like, ACRN was really attracted to me, even as I said, like, it was at a time when you couldn't hear ACRN. You know, it was before web radio, you know, we didn't have a tower, an antenna, anything like that. So it's just people talking to themselves, you know, and playing, you know, terrible songs. But, like, I loved it. We loved it. You know, and we, you know, I was willing to go in and do that, you know, 7, 10 a.m. 3 days a week with my friend, you know, just because it was that important to me. And that sort of combines, you know, like, that's sort of a thing of media. Like, I knew I wasn't going to be a DJ. You know, I was there more for the music and just for the atmosphere than for, like, trying to actually break into radio. But, you know, inadvertently, you know, that's probably the media thing I did that I was, you know, that I remember most fondly now. But the other thing, of course, is The Post. You know, like, I loved The Post, you know, and I was lucky enough to be, you know, a columnist and an editor and just writing about entertainment. And that's, like, you know, the first stories that I wrote about, like, local bands and, like, reviewing shows and reviewing movies and things like that. Like, you know, things that I'm sort of blasé about now, but were incredibly, you know, were unthinkable at the time, you know, and just the thrill, you know, it's corny, but I would sit in, like, the coffee shop and everyone around me would be reading The Post and I would be super jazzed because I was in The Post. Like, you know, it's that initial thrill of feeling that somebody is paying attention to what you're doing, you know, it really feeds your narcissism in, like, hopefully a healthy and not too unhealthy way. And so, yeah, ACRN and The Post are definitely the things that I remember most about this place. You know, I certainly could have gotten web savvier earlier than I did. You know, it's not that actively hurt me. It's just that probably cut off career paths that I'm never going to even know about now. You know, but it's weird. It's like, I kind of got into it, but the first paper I went to, the weekly, the other paper in Columbus, Ohio, like, they had a very limited website. They didn't put everything online. They didn't trust the web. They would have not done a website if they thought they could get away with it. You know, it was entirely focused on print. And that's the way you were taught. And it was just over that period of time you started to realize, it's like, this is getting away from us. Like, I almost told this long story about Jim Rhodes, about the governor of Ohio. When he died, like, they put up a big statue of him downtown. And, of course, he was the guy who sent in the National Guard for the Kent State massacre. And we had this story, this incredible story, this political reporter, I forget the details, but the sculptor had somehow incorporated the names of the victims of the Kent State Massacre into the statue. Like, I don't know if that's a piece of paper or it's written on the metal or something, but it was verified that there was something there that the sculptor had put there without anyone's knowledge that was in this statue that was downtown. And I remember, like, you know, not being a political guy or really, like, knowing that backstory all of it initially, like I was super excited for that story when it came out on that Thursday morning. And I was, I don't know what I thought was going to happen, but I thought things were going to happen. And it was on our website. It was one of the three stories in the paper that week that was on the website, but like no one read the website because they know it was incomplete. They knew it was, you know, sort of half-assed. And the story got no response or very little response. And I just felt that that was a huge injustice. And I think that's when it finally sort of dawned on me that it's like the way we're doing this, you know, it's probably not the right way. And it's you know, there's things are changing in a pretty dramatic way. And so that was sort of my tip off. And so I, you know, all my regrets, such as they are pretty petty, you know, and I can't even really articulate them. You know, I feel like I got what I needed to get out of here. Like the path I took was the path that I wanted to be on. You know, I ended up, you know, frankly, where I wanted to end up. And it's enormous fortune that I'm able to do that, you know, but like I can't say that I would go back here and rewrite history in any kind of dramatic way. I've been on a very specific, I wanted to be a rock critic from when I was 12, 13, 14 years old, you know, reading back issues of Rolling Stone in my orthodontist's office. Like I knew what I wanted to do. This is the only school I applied because it was in state and it was an awesome journalism school. Like I was sort of a laser focus, which is sort of strange. But like I met with an advisor and I sort of explained this plan. It's like, I don't know exactly what I told him, but it was probably like Rolling Stone, Entertainment Weekly. And he's like, you're not going to do that. Like, you're probably not going to do that. You're going to end up living in a hovel in New York City with 10 other people. Like what you should really do is get into a trade magazine, like Plastics Monthly or whatever. Like he wasn't a jerk about it. Like it wasn't unpleasant, but like he was very realist about it. And it was the first sort of direct physical roadblock that I'd encounter. Like the first time that I really realized that this wasn't like going to happen just because I wanted it to happen. There are more opportunities in general, even pop culture journalism, than in music specifically. Like I'm really on a small raft right now in terms of spending all my time like on albums and bands and shows and stuff like that. Like even moving into a sphere where I can also write about sports, about TV, about other things, like that opens up the opportunities pretty immensely. And so that's a more likely scenario for me, both just in terms of the opportunities available and in terms of my interest. You know, I will always love music first, and it's, you know, it'll always be the first thing I think about and the first thing that I write about. You know, but I can get to a place where like it would be healthy for me as a music lover to not be in the industry, you know, to not feel like I had to listen to 400 records that came out that year, a year, you know, to feel like I was on top of things. Like, it's a job, you know, the old Mark Twain thing about the river, and he worked on the river, and now he doesn't see the river the same way. Like that, it's a first world problem extremely, but just when you're writing about music, like you have to listen to all this music. Like you don't get to listen for pleasure. And so there's a part of me that will be a little relieved when I am out, to whatever degree I'm out. But you know, the decision to leave New York was a pretty major one. And as I said, there were a lot of personal reasons. You know, we were about to have a kid and we didn't want to raise a kid in a tiny Brooklyn apartment. My wife didn't really care for it. Like the voice was getting pretty volatile and it was just sort of emotionally affecting me. And so I was looking around for a job and I tried at all journalism places, but I ended up at this digital music company. And that's a point where it started to dawn on me that I wouldn't be doing this forever. Like I started sort of mentally preparing myself for the possibility that like I was going to be out of journalism and that would maybe better for me at this point. That there's something I can do where my experience is valuable, you know, and they'll hire me, you know, and there's enough of the germ of what I used to do that's interesting to me, but like it's a possibility you're not going to be a hardcore full-time journalist anymore. You know, every job that I've had since then, I've been preparing for that moment. I've been pleasantly surprised that moment has not yet arrived. They start somewhere. You know, like what I've said, like I think the should people write for free debate mostly involves like major publications making you write for free, and like that's kind of bullshit, but like most of the people who I've seen come up, you know, most of the young writers who I follow on Twitter, who I'm interested in, who most likely I'm going to end up working with somewhere, have started with their own thing. Like they first gained some level of renown, like through like their own blog or their own Twitter account or like their own thing in some capacity. So just start doing it. Like just start doing the job and putting it on your website. And like I was with ACRN, you're going to be talking to yourself. There was not a lot of discussion about the web while I was here, you know, rightfully so. I mean, it was right on the cusp of it, you know. It feels like a different school in some ways, I'm imagining, if I spent a little time here, you know, and just the mentality that you had is completely different. I did not leave here, I did not leave here with the expectation that I would be primarily an online journalist. You know, it was that simple. And like I said, it was my first job where I sort of realized, you know, that like the earthquake had already hit. You know, so it's just interesting to be here and look into the eyes of journalists in 2004 and try and guess what they're thinking and what they've been told, you know, and sort of marvel at, you know, their bravery, you know, for charging ahead, even though they've been told, you know, wrongly, I think, that like it's over. I don't think it's over, you know, and they know that, and I'm thrilled that they know that. You're not